The following is a production of the Dallas Genealogical Society. For more information, visit us at dallasgenealogy.org.
Okay. And then I'll do a screen share. And hopefully you can see my screen and our two smiling faces. We appreciate folks joining us today. And as always, you just heard, we do record all our presentations so that you can always go back and view them again. I'm Bernard, and you heard Ann talking as well. She's suffering from cedar fever. So you may limit a little bit how much she gets to talk today. We'll give her a try a bit, but we appreciate everybody joining us today. Again, just for anybody who's new joining us, how you find us and find out about our meetings and the recordings of the previous meetings and the like, if you go to the Dallas Genealogical Society website, which is dallasgenealogy.com, and then it's under events is where you go to look for special interest groups. And if you click on that, then the various groups all pop up in alphabetical order. And there we are, the German genealogy group. And that will take you to our page. And way at the top, you can see it's sort of a complex message. If you're trying to type it all by yourself. Okay. Anne, are you able to let people in from the waiting room? Because I see people appearing.
Yes, good. I'm letting people in.
Okay, good. So I don't need to do that. So I have to talk and chew gum at the same time here. So there you can see our page. There's an email, the GGG, that will go to both Anne and me. And like I say, you'll see a notice of our upcoming meetings and link to how you can get to them, and also the recordings of our past meetings. We started recording meetings even before the pandemic. So back when we started in, that was November of 2019. So we have all the meetings, even when we were live, we also recorded them. And I suspect we'll continue to do that once we get to the point where we can meet in person again. We also have a Facebook group. And in between our bi-monthly meetings, we do post number of things we think may be of interest to you on there, as you'll see some of the upcoming webinars that we know about. So we encourage you to join that. Be sure there's a couple of questions we just have as a filter, and please do answer those, and then we'll let you in, and then you can see what's going on in between all our various meetings. And that leads us to the upcoming webinars of some what we think may be potential interest. Next Wednesday, the Family Tree Tours Group has a webinar by Kathy Wirth on German church books, marriage records, customs, traditions. This one is a little bit different. There is a $5 charge to participate in this particular one. Most of the others we'll have are free, but you may find that it is worth the $5, and it supports the group that puts these on. And there's the URL to join for that. Germanology Unlocked is Catherine Schober's new name for her site. And also Thursday afternoon, this is a free webinar, must-know hacks to decipher German town names. And she points out this is the last live webinar she'll be doing for a while, because she has noticed or announced that she and her husband are now expanding their family tree with getting ready to have their first child. And anybody who's had a child knows they do tend to take a bit of your time. I think not only when they're young infants, even when they're like 19, 20 years old sometimes. So, but she'll be doing on a maternity leave. So this will be her last live webinar for a while. It is a free one. And again, that's a long URL, but we've posted it to our Facebook group. So if you're a member of the Facebook group, you can find that post and just click on it there to register. This one is really being announced a lot of different places. She has 1,000 seats for it, but I'm seeing lots of different other organizations are posting this one. The Germanic Genealogy Society that evening of Thursday has Stephen Morse talking about his one-step web pages. And this is something he's won a number of awards for. If you have any interest at all at the upcoming release of the 1950 census, he's got a whole bunch of tools that you can use with that to help you find your relatives until they get a good index. National Archives is going to experiment with an index this time. We didn't have one at all with the 1940 census. But computer indices, trying to figure out the handwriting of 140,000 enumerators can be a bit of a challenge. And again, this webinar is free and has the registration information again already posted to our Facebook group. Then the following week, Wednesday, January 19th, the St. Louis Genealogical Society, their German special interest group, is hosting Carol Witten talking about German newspapers, which we were just talking about leading up to the call here. And we will post this one to our Facebook group as well. As you can see, it's another long URL to register. And the Ohio chapter of the Palatines to America, their German Genealogy Society, has a free webinar on the Saturday, the 22nd, that's 2 weeks from now, strategies for reading German church records and how you do it, how you figure out the names. You don't have to know how to order off the menu in a German restaurant to figure out how to decipher German church records. So you don't have to be fluent in all of German, just know the particular keywords and the locations and the like. For that particular one, you do need to send an email to that society. Again, we'll put that on the Facebook. Since we are members of the Dallas Genealogical Society, the spring seminar is coming up on Saturday, April 23rd. This is Diane Southard, an excellent presenter and a good expert on DNA. Her theme is using DNA strategically, tools to identify ancestors, and she'll have four different presentations she'll be giving that day. There is a registration fee. Members of the society do get a discount, and that should appear on the society's website very soon. And then Legacy Family Tree webinars, they do offer a number, I think it was 119 free webinars throughout the year, each year. And I sort of looked through and really couldn't find anything particularly German related as one of those free webinars. And then they also have a subscription with obviously lots and lots of webinars, some of which are German speakers and presenters. But they're announced this year, they're also going to do some free online conferences, one each month. And May will be the month which they will do a German free online conference. And that's about all the details we have for it at this point. We do have a meeting coming up again the second Saturday in May, our meeting. And certainly we'll put more details on our Facebook site as we get it and also at that next meeting. And now I just want to do a quick check to see who we have here. So if you'll please just take a minute to respond and just get an idea of who we might have and how many folks we've got. Okay, very good. And we see everybody is a DGS member. So we do welcome guests as well. So if you've got friends, then you don't have to be a member of the society to join any of the special interest groups. But thank you for that. As I mentioned, our upcoming meetings in March, we'll be back at our regular time. Again, we meet the second Saturday of the month. The main Dallas Society usually meets the first Saturday, but because of the New Year's holiday, they backed up to today. So when they meet in the morning, then we switch to this afternoon time. But for our next two meetings in March and then in May, we'll be back at the 10:30 time. In March, that'll be Teresa Burns. She's Teresa Burns Translations, and she is in Germany. So she'll be talking to us from Germany. And then in May, we have Sue Kaufman from the official name is the Clayton Library Center for Genealogical Research. Most of us will refer to it just as the Clayton Library, and we know what that is. And she'll be talking about the various holdings that are available. And if you're not aware, you can go on their site and get a library card. You don't have to be a resident of Houston or Harris County to be eligible to get a card to their library. And she'll be talking about the various holdings that they have available there. So those are our two upcoming meetings. So be sure to put those on your calendar as well. And then for today, rather than have a presenter, I thought we'd have folks sort of join in here and talk a bit about German genealogy books. And in particular, not necessarily books you go look for in the library, big expensive things or large many volume sets, but things you may have in your own personal library. And Anne and I both came up with our own little lists, and it was interesting to see how much overlap we had between the two. And with your contributions and ours, we'll put together a list and then share that with everybody. So basically, all we're just looking for is tell us the title of the book, the author, if you know it, and maybe any ideas of your suggestions, thoughts of why you found that helped you in your research. So at this point, if you have something to tell us about, feel free to unmute yourself and tell us about one of your favorite research books.
Okay. I want to kick off an example, or Kathleen as an example.
Kathleen Scott Sutton.
Yes. I went, just to give it a little context, I'm not proficient in German research, and so I haven't really done any German research for the last 2 years, but prior to that, I was very eager to and had a lot of success finding my rooters in Cologne who were merchants. And so anyway, when I was first starting a few years back, the thing that I really needed to know or to ramp up on was the kind of German, the vocabulary I needed to know to be able to read. So what I picked out, and I have it all sort of written out, I typed out in a Word doc, which I'll just send to y'all. But so I have the first book. Oh, and also the thing that confronted me was the history of Germany. What I remembered was about, of course, the Holy Roman Empire. And then following that, of course, World War II and Germany. And that was like, you know, I really, in everything that happened from Napoleon to to World War II, essentially, World War I was a mystery to me. So really, and my ancestors, of course, emigrated during that period that was a mystery to me. So I had to go back and understand German history. So the first book that I ran into, and I don't remember where I picked this thing up yet, was this little volume. It's 26 pages, and it was written by Anita Mallinckrodt, Dr. Anita Mallinckrodt. And it was written in 1988, and it was Why They Left, German Immigration from Prussia to Missouri. What I noted about it that was so wonderful to match my needs is that it really doesn't talk about Missouri hardly at all. And it talks about the history of immigration and why they left. And it's all centered in Prussia and in Germany in general. So, and she does a parallel structure of saying, okay, so in 1818, this is what's going on in Germany, particularly in Prussia, or what was Prussia at that time. And then she will say it in the United States to give you a grounding. She'll tell you what was going on. So it was really, it's a small book. She writes very well. She's fairly erudite. It has references to it, but they're all from the Missouri Historical Review, but you know, whatever, at least they're there. And so if you want to get just a pretty concise, I guess, read, you would say, of Germany and the historical changes that happened in Germany, I found this book very insightful as a beginner. And then I went of course, and it was small to read. So, you know, you didn't have to read a tome. It was very nice like that. And so anyway, and I just now, right when y'all were talking, I was looking up, where can you get this bloody book? And it was, the first thing that came up, of course, was Amazon. And they wanted $75 for this 26-page little pamphlet. So I guess I ought to digitize it and make it available if anybody wants it. I mean, it's not out of copyright, but she died in 2019. So I don't know if anybody's following her legacy or not. But anyway, that's the book. So it's called Why They Left, German Immigration from Prussia to Missouri. But I will say that the biggest insight I got out of this was the history of Germany. The next book that I mentioned, I only read it online. It was an ebook, and I was traveling from somewhere to Germany, Norway probably. And I really needed to ramp up my German, you know, so get the keywords right, because we were going to the Catholic archives in Cologne, and all the records were in German. So I got this little book, I'm trying to see if I can list it here. Oh, right. It's only 11 pages long. and it was written by Austin. I don't know how he would say this name, but Gazelle, I think. And it's a German to English genealogical dictionary. But it hit all the high points. If you have a very brief amount of time, and or you just haven't looked at your German for a long time, and you just need to know it. He talks about, of course, that these things, there are many, many books that have this stuff in it, but writing script, and these are all the German words for, obviously the script, what the script looks like, life events, family relationships, religions, numbers, and the calendar. So days and months and years. And it's like, you know, that's the key stuff, you know, to be able to communicate with or be able to pick out words. So I recommend this little book. I will say that I looked at this book. It's on Amazon too. It's cheap. It's like $2.99 or $4.99. But they had four reviews, and two of them were like, you know, this is not worth the pittance they ask for. You can find this crap anywhere. And then the next one, the other two reviews were like, it's succinct, it's just what I needed, you know, bang on. So I leave you with that. This is a very small investment, but if I find it very useful for being on a plane or being in transit to ramp up my German really quickly. Now, a book by the same title is one that Catherine Schober represented when I took her course, or recommended. Which is Ernest Thode's German to English Genealogical Dictionary. And it's the Dallas Public Library does have this, and it is a major book. And it's got wonderful front matter if you want to look at it before he gets to his extensive dictionary. But he's got abbreviations, terms, male and female names, surnames, occupations was helpful. And then months and numbers, et cetera, and a couple of maps that were very helpful. So that's a great book. And I found this other book that I'll also talk about, which was John Heise's 1985 German for Genealogy. It was a translator's handbook. And that's what Mr. Heise was. And it's also very brief. It's only 30 pages. And it has all the usual content in terms of, you know, it shows you the script and gives you the abbreviations, et cetera. But what this book had as references was kind of helpful. Where they had diseases. So if you're looking at deaths in German, and also the various titles that folks might have. And it had what was really helpful if you're looking at Catholic Church records, often in Latin or sometimes in Latin, sometimes in Cologne, also in French. But it had a Latin glossary and Latin abbreviations, which were, you know, also a wonderful refresher to go back and be able to pick out the keywords in sacramental records And then it had maps. I mean, if you had to pick two maps, you had the former German states and present-day Germany. And so this is also another one of those small things that you could get that is very brief. It's 30 pages that I found very helpful. So my recommendations are primarily, I think, for beginners, people who aren't, you know, deep in their understanding or their knowledge of Germany. But that's my stuff.
Okay, thanks, Kathleen. That was very helpful. And yeah, as you mentioned, it, you know, depends where you are in your research of what books and other resources might be of the best value to you. For example, for my Meissners, I'm back in the 1600 church records, which were written in Latin. Although some of the ones you may even find in America are written in Latin as well. So then you're going through and figuring out those words as opposed to the German words and figuring out the German script. Usually they're pretty good, at least, that they write out the names in a recognizable form. So that even if you have a little more trouble figuring out all the rest of the words, usually the words are written out often in the, even in the, what, 1800s in a more modern script, I found. So, and you also talked about knowing the history. That was sort of the topic we just heard this morning at the Dallas Society's main meeting about the value of history and really putting some meat on the bones of understanding, you know, why did our ancestors decide to leave, what was happening where they were, or sometimes they decided to stay or other family members did. And, you know, why did they come to America? And in many cases, they weren't just saying, I'm going to America. We heard some of that our last November meeting with the Palatines, that there, you know, Queen Anne in England was just saying, we need to populate the colonies. So we need people to come and we'll send you to where we decide to send you. But in most cases, individuals, when they were going to go to America, wasn't just America, they had a particular place in mind. So understanding the history and what their experience would be, was like, can be very valuable. And there are a number of books that can give you some good resources for that. So thanks again. Somebody else says something they want to share? He's a longtime teacher. I'm comfortable with this dead air for a while. It makes people a little bit more willing to volunteer. But let me just add one more then, if I get the click here. We did get an email this morning from Marianne Szabo, who was not able to attend our meeting, but she did have a book she wanted to recommend. And this is similar again of looking at the historical aspects. It's called German Hometowns, Community State, in the state. It's a book. Let me move screens around here. When you're looking at books, you want to pay attention often to the date at when they were written. If it's something about, oh, here's the latest and greatest records on the internet or something, you probably want a more recent publication date. But for something like that, where you're talking about the history and what was life like long time ago, you know, 1998 is as valuable as something for 2018. But this talks about German hometowns, where you had the burghers. Those were the people who were the official citizens of the town and got to vote. Other people were residents but were not burghers. And then just talking about what happened over the years. You know, historically there was the feudal aspect to society, where the lord sort of dictated everything from who could live in the town and if and when you could get married and the like. And then gradually over time, that sort of morphed into something a bit different. Talks about the Holy Roman Empire, Napoleonic reforms, the Revolution 1848, when it sort of started, they wanted to get more of a democratic sort of society. So again, depending on the time period, it will matter, but it gives you a good feeling, any of these ones, of looking at what was life back there when they were living, that it was not the same as what may have been going on in the United States at the same time. Just because it's always in genealogy, the time and place is very important to consider. So this is a book Marianne has recommended. She mentioned this is not in the Dallas Library, but as many others, you can find it on Amazon and other places. And this might be one as a result of this meeting and some of the suggestions you folks offer. We may suggest to Stephanie from the library as some potential ones to add to the shelves. So just another one to consider. Anybody else?
Bernard, who wrote that book?
Let me go back down again. Down. Mac Walker and James Sheehan.
Okay.
And again, we'll put together a list of all these books to share with you after the meeting. So that will be another benefit of being a part of our group.
I was looking at online at this, and JSTOR actually has a book by the pretty much the German hometowns 40 years later. That people, some of you might be interested in, or can get your JSTOR through, if you're lucky enough, through your local university. But it was written in 2014. So I'm wondering if it might be of some interest to people too.
Yeah, there's a whole bunch out there. As we heard this morning, you can find some books that are sort of historical fiction, and then you want to pay attention to how much have they researched it, how much is historic and how much is fiction. But again, if they've done a lot of good research on it, that can be a valuable resource. And often it's a little bit lighter reading than when we're trying to dig through records and the like. What's next? Okay, Anne, do you want to talk about one of the books on your list?
Oh gosh, I had so many. I had a huge list.
Okay, a little great. Head.
Great,
because this will be on your list when you get it, folks. So,
yeah, I just messed up here. Trying to make it bigger, and I need to close the participants list. Maybe that will help and close the chat, and that will make me be able to see that picture a little bit. Yeah. Some of the ones that I have are for obviously translation purposes, and that's the second row. It kind of looks like there with the German English dictionary that Kathleen talked about from Ernst Thode, and this deciphering German records is the original old version. So a long, long time ago, this is all we had. It's a spiral bound thing, and it was updated in 2006. But I have the 19 whatever 90 something version of this one. So this is good. The Ernst Thode book is the one I refer to the most right now, because it has like the acronyms, like what does an A dot stand for, or D dot, or whatever, you know, all the different little, like, I don't know, NP or whatever the, you know, different things are that you find in records. You can find him in his dictionary and extrapolate kind of what it's referring to by his dictionary. So that's why I kind of like his dictionary at this point. So that's kind of my favorite one that I'm using right now, mostly. I am looking at a lot of German records. So that's my first favorite one. Okay.
Yeah, I'll mention that one. Like I say, Kathleen and Ann have talked about the front of the book, where it has a lot of that useful information. Then it does actually use a whole dictionary and has all the words with their little meanings and the like. But like any dictionary, of course, it's in alphabetic order. So then that sort of requires you have to know the spelling of the word. So, but there can be other places to figure that out. But it is very helpful and very detailed. Okay, we talked about for people sort of starting out, there's a couple books we have up here. You'll see a couple by James Beidler. He's a very active genealogist based out of central Pennsylvania. So he has the folks from Lancaster and the like as well. This is now a 2016 guide of Complete Guide to German Genealogy Websites. Well, as of 2016, and here we are now 6 years later, so it may be getting time for him to do another edition, but goes through some of the basic sites, Ancestry and Family Search. We often see on some of the Facebook's postings, well, I looked on Ancestry and couldn't find it. Well, did you look on Family Search? And a lot of people are not familiar with that. And then you get into other sort of lesser known resources. The Archaon is particularly good for Protestant church sites. And then there was we have a site, Matricula, for a number of the Catholic sites as well. But again, it's sort of a basic book that can sort of get you started on places to look. And like I say, you'll see he has several different books and also gives a number of webinars as well. Another name you'll see mentioned, and we talked about already, she's getting ready to go under maternity leave. Catherine Schober has two different books she's written. This is The Magic of German Church Records, a very recent book, 2020. And goes through and shows you examples of the various records. Some are in tabular form, some might be in paragraphs. Obviously, there are many are in German, some are in Latin, as you go further back in time, or depending on the inclination of the minister in some cases. This can be another book you might find of value when you're looking at getting to the point of having the church records. So again, as I said, it depends on, you know, where are you in your research? Are you sort of starting out and you're still working over here in the United States to try to figure out where are the hometowns? And I've got at least one family, my great-great-grandparent Ott family in Western Pennsylvania. I'm really trying to figure out where did they come from? And trying to sort through and find some church records and the like. I've looked at visited the library there in their community. They're sort of up the river from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. But that's been sort of a challenge. On the other hand, with my Meissners, I've got back into the 1650s. And a lot of that was once I posted the stuff I had of a third great-grandfather, I got one of those hints on Ancestry for a Meissner living in Germany who had all these other records of churches that he had mentioned as his sources, although he hadn't posted the actual records. So I actually hired a genealogist to go back. These are ones not online, go to the archive and get them. And then the process of trying to transcribe and then translate the records. So in that case, some of these other books are a little bit more advanced, like this one, A Genealogist Translation Guide. This is volume 4, which is Polish, German, Latin, and Russian. And I've done a whole series of these. It's a pretty thick book, a rather expensive book, but again, gives a number of different examples, talking a bit about what things were like at that time period as well. So again, depending where you are in your research, various books can be of use to you at a certain period, and then you've sort of outgrown those and grown into another book.
The map books, I don't know if you can show the map book, that one there. This was really helpful because it shows all the transitions through time. Obviously, Germany wasn't Germany, right? And so it shows the variations of Prussia. It shows the Austria-Hungary, where some Germans, went into, what is now Poland and Austria and Hungary and all that. And it shows even one of the areas that I was asked to find somebody in was Galicia. Well, Galicia only existed as a country for a little while, but it's in this book and it shows exactly where it was and how then it overlaid on today, Hungary and Austria border basically. And it kind of helped me in my research to see it on a map. So this was a map book that I like.
Yeah, that could be very helpful because again, the boundaries may move around, but the records tend to stay where they were made. So the records made in Galicia are still in what used to be Galicia in most cases. And then you're trying to figure, okay, well, what is that now? Where's that location? And that's a case where the maps can be very helpful. And somebody else have something they wanted to say? Thought I heard a voice.
So one of the things Kathleen mentioned was to Missouri. You go to the bottom second book,
mm-hmm.
Click on that one. I have a lot of people in Illinois. So I have a lot of people in the Chicago area. And so this is talking about all the Germans in the Chicago area between 1850 and World War I, which is a time period when a lot of my ancestors were coming into the country. So you may look for something like either the one Kathleen talked about or whatever for wherever region your ancestors were from, because it can give you some good insight to what it was like there in that particular region.
Right, we have that one. One I found just doing searches online is for Minnesota Germans coming from Russia. We had a presentation earlier on last year of the Germans from Russia group. But this is the case of, all right, now you're in Minnesota, but your heart, your mind, your history is all in Russia. So what's home? And what do you do with memories or food or the like? So this is a series of essays of people who belong to the local chapter of the Germans from Russia who are being children in one of those other places, and now you're in the United States. They even, because those families had left Germany, back when often Catherine the Great invited them to come to Russia. So they left and developed their own dialects of German and had their own even German words for things. And I've read cases where they met in Minnesota Germans from another part, maybe Prussia or the like, and had to end up speaking English because they didn't understand each other's German anymore. And we have the same thing in Texas, that there's the University of Texas at Austin has a group trying to record the German, Texas German, essentially, because there's still a number of older people who have been passed down for generations of the German they learned from their grandparents who came over, often in cases before the Civil War. So this can be another case. Again, look at location where your folks moved to or were living and get the feeling for what the experience is like. Maybe where did the folks come from? If you're still trying to find that hometown, often there were groups of people that came, or the chain migration that somebody came first and then they saved up money and wrote back, and then another family member came and they saved up money and the next one came. So they had a reason for coming, but where they came from, if you're trying to find a hometown, this can often be of value to you. So there's a number of these books talking about, you know, the life in the old world and the new world. So things you can consider that way. Well, our book, I'll mention that as always, and we have, you know, the excitement now of the 1950 census will be released in just a couple months. And was it the British census was just released this past week, their 1921 census. They have sort of different rules on how long the privacy is in place. But it's always the talk about German census records. And it's sort of one of the myths that there are no census records for Germany. Well, turns out that's not quite the case. And the author here, Roger Meinert, is another name you'll see often. He's been a university professor doing a lot of research in Germany and actually took a sabbatical to go over to Germany and visit a number of different archives. And in some cases, he'd go to the archivist and said, well, I'm doing research on German census records. And the archivist would say, census records? Nah, we don't have any in our archive here. And Dr. Meinert said, well, is it okay if I go in the back and just sort of look? And I said, so sure, go ahead. And in a couple of hours, he'd come out and say, look what I found. You have census records. So they did it more often for tax purposes of how you distributed the money that they were collecting. But they start off collecting names, but often the list of names stayed at the locale, the little town, village, or whatever. And then they just sent summary statistics up the line. But he has, he's gone through the research of this 100-year period when a lot of our ancestors maybe were born in Germany and then came over to the States, but lists by the German states. You can look through in Bavaria. When did Bavaria do censuses? And where might you find them? In some cases, what sort of questions were they asking? So while there's only a few that are online, a lot of these census records do, in fact, exist. And where people think, oh, all we have are the civil records, and then before the 1870s, the church records. Well, lo and behold, there are census records as well that you may want to consider doing some work on. And this is a good reference. This might be one of the ones you may not want for your personal library, but one to sort of go check in the library, see if they have it, and then go look for the place of interest to you. So in addition to the church records, we talked earlier about newspaper records, census records can also be of value to you. Okay, somebody else.
Did you put the military one on here from Hanover?
Sean, did I miss that? I don't think I have it.
I don't see it.
Shame on me.
Teresa McMillan, who lives in Illinois. I think she lives in Palatine, Illinois. Anyway, she's a German speaker. She does a lot of presentations. Okay. And she's very good. She does presentations at the international conferences and things like that. She wrote a book, and she spent a lot of time in the Family History Center in Salt Lake City. And she wrote a book that's quite thick on Hanover military records. And the reason she did this was because the microfilm, and I have found this as well, the indexes that Family Search has for some of the microfilms don't match the real film, okay? And so she basically went through and put the whole history, and again, this is the region of Hanover, and I know not everybody has those kind of ancestors, but for me, it was important. And it gave each battalion when they changed numbering, where they were, you know, and how to find the records and what type of records that were available in Family Search for each and every unit in the Hanover military throughout time. And it's awesome for me, but maybe there's something for your region too. I don't know. I'm not familiar with all the regions, whether they have a book like that or not, but anyway, I just thought I'd throw that out.
All right. Thanks, Anne. Yeah, I don't know why I overlooked and didn't put that on there. And again, a reminder of what you can do nowadays since the start of the pandemic, the Family History Library does have these consultations where you can set up an appointment with a time and Zoom or whatever software they're using with the person for up to sort of half an hour or so and say, this is what I'm looking for. What suggestions might you have? And then if they say, oh, we got something in the library, we have this book with a couple of pages that might be of interest to you, and they can actually make copies of those pages and send them to you. So they could do a lookup that way. Again, it's sort of difficult these days to travel to Salt Lake City. I guess the library is back open finally again, so that you can't go there. But what's evolved in the interim is they have this service now so that you can make use of that. First talk to somebody and see if there's a book of the area records of which you're particularly interested, or if they have a little knowledge of it. And then in some cases, again, you know, they've now digitized everything that they had on microfilm. And much of that is available freely on the web. Some is still restricted just because of the contracts they had with whoever owns the records. In some cases, you have to go to a local family history center. And the number of those are now opening up to one extent or another. But otherwise, you know, they can, in that case, even make copies and send them to you. So that is another option. And in fact, the Dallas Library has the same sort of service as well. And they are officially an affiliate library of the Family History Library. So there was one microfilm, this was Irish research I was doing, that side of my family. And the record was there, but it was one of those microfilms not available. It's now been digitized and searchable by computer, but you had to go to a Family History Center and they were all closed. I contacted the Dallas Library and one of the librarians went and looked up. They were able to access it and give me the page I needed to find my ancestor. So again, you know, you can look in the catalog of the Family Search to see what all they have as terms of books, but you can also contact one of their folks, set up a consultation, and they can help you maybe find a book. Okay, and the last thing I have on here are two of the DNAs, which first saying, well, is this German or not? Well, to an extent, yes, it is. Blaine Bettinger has been doing a lot of work, gives a lot of talks about DNA. And this is a little bit more of sort of the, you know, it's sort of plain English, but takes you through all the details of what are the kind of tests, why you may want to take one. It's often, you know, they ask you, well, what's the question you're trying to answer? And then that's how you decide what test to take, as opposed to, okay, I'll take a test and maybe magically I'll find my relatives. I haven't had much luck on my own with German relatives, although there's a number of Germans now who have been taking DNA tests. They're obviously everywhere in Europe and even a little maybe more in Germany. Privacy is still a big concern for them just based on their history and the like. But this is sort of a book that sort of helps you that way. And then the other one on the list, and again, I mentioned she's going to be the spring seminar presenter for the Dallas Genealogical Society coming up, Diane Southard. Her book is a little bit different in that it's, what's your question? Okay, turn to these pages, and this is what you want to do. Again, she's a very good presenter, has very good graphics as well. has her own Facebook group and the like. And this book is a number of the more recent books you can either get digital or hard copy. And this one she's had digital for a while, and only recently is there now is a printed version of it. Again, DNA is sort of a new thing for us in genealogy in the last decade or so. And in many cases, people are able to find connections to relatives by getting DNA matches. So something else you may want to consider of having access to is sort of books for help you with German research. So does anybody have anything else they want to add? Okay, if not, then I'll just consider end it there. Like I say, I'll put together the list of all the books we've got, and we'll make that available to everyone. And a reminder of our upcoming meetings. Our next meeting will be in March with Teresa Burns. And in the interim, again, check our Facebook page for all those other webinars coming up in the next month or two. Some of them we already have notices on the Facebook, and the others we will add. And at this point, where's my stop recording button?
Probably in the dot, 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 if
you've... Yeah. Stop recording. Yeah, there we go. Okay.
This has been a production of the Dallas Genealogical Society. If you are already a member, thank you. If you are not a member, please consider joining today by visiting dallasgenealogy.org and clicking on the membership tab. Your membership dues will help us support the genealogy section of the Dallas Public Library, as well as help continue our education and preservation efforts.